Okay, good morning all the students. Recently I have spoken to few of the students and they gave a critical feedback on the machine learning classes that have been handled so far, and I got some feedback on that. Let me address those issues first. Say some of the students are feeling it is fast going, so that I can control, because it is under my control. I can see that the classes will be handled at a ample pace, so that you can at a sufficient speed, so that you can all understand. Okay, and one more issue is using complex words. I am using some complex words or terminology during the classes, so that some of the students can't understand it properly. But what I am trying to explain, or what I'm trying to tell you, is machine learning concepts have some complex nomenclature. Complex nomenclature means complex words or complex terminology. See, these words have to be used in that context as it is. I can't change the terminology, right? But still it is under my control. What I can do is, whenever I use some complex word, I try to substitute with a simpler word, so that I'll use both of them together. And I'll repeat the sentence so that you can understand where exactly that can be used and what is the actual meaning of that word, right? And also, you need to improve your mark. I can't simply speak in the school level or graduation level English now also, because if we do like that, your mark can't be increased, right? Your mark can't be improved. So what I'm trying to tell you is, I'll use the words which are complex, but I'll also try to explain you that particular word, so that your benchmark will be updated. You can start improving your English. You try to do that. See, when we go for some faculty development programs, or when we go to some motivational talks, we come across a lot of complex words, but we feel very happy to note down those words and see that meaning in the dictionary, and try to use those words in different contexts to the students, or wherever we give a lecture or deliver a talk, right? So what we are trying to do is improve at every stage. You also have to do in that way. If I'm using a word which is not understandable, try to note it down and try to find the meaning in the dictionary, or easily you can Google it, right? And see the usage of that word under the meaning of that word, so that you can understand in which context that can be used. And because this is not a physical lecture class, online, you can repeat the video again and see in what context I have used that particular word, right? And it can be understood easily once you know the meaning. So little hard work, if you put, you can improve the way you talk, the way you understand the lessons. That is my intention, right? But still, whenever I use a complex word, I'll also try to use a simpler word for that to make you understand. Okay, that I'll take completely under my control. You need not worry about that. Okay. And now machine learning has lots and lots of mathematics lying behind, lots of complex terms and derivations lying behind. But one thing I want to tell you is, without learning all these things, you can still be a machine learning expert by using the predefined algorithms. You have lots of libraries in Python in order to fit data to various machine learning algorithms and see the best performing model and give that as your output. Correct. But what is the use? I'll give you one example. A chef opening a restaurant, and a layman who doesn't know anything about cooking opening a restaurant. Tell me, what is the difference? Can anyone tell me what is the difference between a chef opening a restaurant and a layman who doesn't know the ABCD of cooking opening a restaurant? What will happen? Who will flourish?
The chef.
Chef. Why? Because if at all his workers doesn't come, if at all the chefs he employed doesn't come, or they suddenly stop coming, going to a better, taking a better opportunity. In that case, chef himself can handle the situation, right? So he never allows bad feedback from his customers. and he'll always be ready to take up any adversities or any difficulties he come across, because he knows the core fundamentals of cooking to handle a restaurant. Whereas a layman, if the chef doesn't turn up on one day, that whole day he has to close the restaurant and sit. That may turn into a bad feedback by the customers, right? So learning the intricacies, learning the complexities, learning the basics of any subject is very, very important. That is why you have to learn the mathematics behind this machine learning algorithms, the fundamentals, the statistical significance, the hypothesis or statements you make about a particular problem, right? All these are very much essential for a good machine learning expert in order to develop a model that would better generalize. Generalize means, I said already, generalize is if you give a new data point which is not seen by the machine, still it should be able to generalize that. Correct? That is a good machine learning model. Right? That is what I want my students to become. Simply learning a subject by hearting will not do anything. It will not be beneficial to you. You have to learn the basic fundamentals of a subject in order to excel in that particular area. Say you are fitting a model, you are trying an algorithm with your data set, but can you understand, can you infer whether that model is a good fit to your data or not? Yeah, machine is giving very good performance, but underlying it may be overfitting. Overfitting means it is predicting properly for every type of data. And if at all an unseen data point comes, it may not be able to predict. In some cases, extreme cases, it may not perform well. But you will not be able to understand why it is not performing well if you don't know the background details, if you don't know the basics of these statistics or maths underlying this machine learning. So you have to understand all these fundamentals in order to become a good machine learning expert, right? So before going forward with your theory, let me explain you the basic nomenclature or the basic terms which we use in machine learning. I think this should have been done first so that you won't feel alien to this subject. You don't feel new to this subject, right? So let me explain you all the basic terms which we use in machine learning today, so that from Monday's class, we'll understand all the concepts that we are going to deal with further easily, okay? So let me open a presentation, a blank presentation, so that I'll explain on that. Okay, let me know if you can see the blank presentation. Yes, students, you can see this?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, now what is the first term I commonly use, or any machine learning terminology contains, is assumption. What assumption we make about the problem statement. Say you have a problem like this. You want to classify whether a transaction is a fraudulent transaction or not. So what type of problem it is? Yes or no, whether it is fraudulent or not. So I'm trying to classify it. Say a transaction is given to me. I want to say whether it is a fraudulent transaction or not. In that case, I'm trying to classify a problem as yes or no, right? So this is called as classification problem. Means I'm trying to assume, I am trying to make an assumption that for this problem, classification is a better technique, because I'm trying, my outcome is whether to say yes or no to something. Okay, in this case, it is whether a fraudulent transaction or not, or whether a customer will be a defaulter or not in the case of loan payment, or whether a customer will stay loyal to a particular service provider or he will move to a different company or not. Yes or no, loyal customer, yes or no, like that. Okay, what I'm trying to do here is I'm trying to classify the data points at hand into two different categories, right? Into two different classes. So I'm calling this as classification problem. Means based on the problem, based on the data I have, and based on the outcome I'm expecting, based on what type of task I'm going to perform, I'm making an assumption that this is a classification task. Now, I have another problem. I want to find out or I want to predict the stock price of a particular share. And I have been studying it for a long time, historical data, and I'm trying to predict what would be its price tomorrow so that I can sell that particular stock in order to get some profit. I'm trying to predict what here? I'm trying to predict the price. Price is always a numerical value. Now I'm trying to predict the price. When I'm trying to predict the price, or when I'm trying to predict the weather, or when I'm trying to predict humidity, or when I'm trying to predict rainfall in a particular area, what I'm trying to do here? I'm trying to regress. I'm trying to perform regression. Means based on previous data, based on previous parameters, so by studying those parameters, if I'm trying to forecast rainfall, if I'm trying to forecast in a particular drought area, means where there is no rainfall for a long time, now I wanted to predict, I want to forecast what would be the rainfall level in the future. How I can do that? I can see the rainfall level in the previous years, precipitation, humidity, wind, and lots of other such climatic factors comes into picture. Weather specific factors comes into picture, right? Now, humidity plays big role, say 3x1. And wind speed plays a nominal role. So I'm giving it as weight 1, and precipitation it is playing a major role. So I'm giving it as x3. Means I'm giving this more importance, this less importance, this the highest importance. Okay, I'm giving the precipitation highest importance, humidity moderate importance, and breeze or wind, I'm giving the lowest importance. Because how can I arrive at this decision? By studying the old records of weather conditions in that particular area, right? This I'm trying to explain with an equation in order to predict what the rainfall. Understand this clearly. I'm taking the term x1 for humidity. I'm trying to take x2 for wind speed, and I'm trying to take x3 to explain precipitation, right? I'm taking three parameters in order to predict rainfall. Now what are the weights given to them? Is given by studying the historical data and fitting a linear equation which explains the previous data better, so that it helps me to predict future rainfall. Did you understand this clearly? Now, what I'm trying to predict is the rainfall in centimeters or in millimeters. I'm trying to predict a numerical value. Now, I have some data at hand and my task is to predict some numerical value, forecast some numerical value. So, what is my problem here? It is a regression problem. Previously, it is a classification problem because I'm trying to classify the data points. Here, it is a regression problem because I'm trying to predict something which would happen in the future. Right? Means by taking the problem statement, I'm repeating this again, by taking the problem statement, by taking the data at hand and what type of task I'm trying to perform, I'm making assumptions that this is a classification task or this is a regression task or this is a clustering task, this is a grouping task. Right? I'm trying to make assumptions. Assumption means I'm assuming this may be correct or may not be correct. This decision of thinking that this problem is a classification problem or a regression problem is my assumption. Is I am assuming that this may be correct. Yes, this may fit and my model will work very well. And this may not be correct. The model is giving very bad performance. Because my assumption is wrong. Remember, assumption can't be tested beforehand. It has to be tested only by checking the performance of a model, by checking how good a model is predicting something or classifying something. Okay? That is called assumption. Now, I want you to think on this for half a minute and ask me if you have any doubts. Because I will be using this assumption term throughout machine learning subject. So if you have any doubt in this or you want me to explain it once again, ask me. Don't sit in the cover of a decent student with doubts. That will harm you a lot. Basic doubt, simple doubt, silliest doubts will be entertained in my class. You have to ask that. Because you may not be the only person because you asked. You will be voicing some other students' doubts also. So I always encourage you to ask doubts. And you know interaction points are there for the students who ask doubts in the class and who answer questions. So this silence, I'm assuming, I'm making an assumption that you're thinking on the topic and I would get some doubts from the students.
Ma'am, can you explain classification again, ma'am? Because I joined late, that's why.
Who is this?
Apoorva, ma'am.
You have to join on time, okay? Okay, I'll do that again. See, whenever you want to classify the data given to you, say there are some lifestyle parameters like a person is smoking and a person has overweight and he eats junk food and he drinks. These are the parameters to classify whether a person will get diabetes or not. Right? So there are parameters X1, X2, X3, X4, which will decide the outcome variable Y, the predicting and the classification variable Y, whether he'll be a diabetes patient, S or no. Okay? In classification problem also, you have parameters. Even in regression problem also, you have parameters, but you're treating them in a different way. In regression, you are trying to fit all those parameters with some weight, which will better explain the behavior of the outcome variable. In this case, it is rainfall. But here what you are trying, by taking his body mass index, BMI, by taking his weight, by taking his smoking habit, or by taking his drinking habit, you are trying to classify whether he is prone to acquire diabetes or not. Whether he may get the disease of diabetes or not, S or no. You're trying to classify him, right? That is called the classification problem. So whenever you're given a problem statement, you should immediately understand first what should be your outcome. based on your outcome, you can make an assumption that this would be a classification problem or this would be a regression problem. But sometimes in rare cases, the data may be very confusing that you may not make a correct assumption, but still you can start off with one preliminary assumption, one fundamental assumption that it is a classification problem or it is a regression problem and see whether your model is giving good performance or not. Good performance means what? Whether it is doing something with good accuracy or not, whether it is performing the intended task with good accuracy or not. Yes, if it is performing with good accuracy, the assumption you have made is correct. If it is not performing with good accuracy, lots of things have to be considered. Maybe the model may not be correct, means the machine learning algorithm you have selected may not be correct, or the data captured may not be sufficient, or the initial assumption that it is a classification problem itself may be wrong. In that case, you may have to check with regression problem. Okay, so what overall view of what I'm trying to tell you is, you are given some data and you are asked to perform some task in the future by learning from that data. Think you are a machine. Okay, now you are given some data and you are asked to predict something in the future by using that data. That's it. So you are learning from the data and you are performing a task of classification or regression, so that if you are given with new data points, you should still be able to generalize properly. Means you should be still able to classify it properly by learning from the data given to you. Now, I'm giving you a new patient data. Now, this patient is smoking. This patient doesn't drink. And he is not overweight. He is with proper weight. And he is he'll not eat junk food. Only thing is, he is smoking. Now, what is his chance of acquiring diabetes? Now, the machine would have learned such combinations, right? A person doesn't drink, a person smokes, a person doesn't eat junk food, and he is having proper weight, not overweight or underweight. In that case, most of the time in the data, none of the patients acquired diabetes. So, because you learned from the data, what would you predict now? Will the patient acquire diabetes or not?
No.
No, exactly. So that is how a machine learns from the historic data and it tries to predict with a new data point. Now, another patient data I'm giving the machine. Now, this patient drinks, this patient eats junk food, this patient smokes, but he is with proper weight. Now, it again has experience of encountering such patient data, of going through such patient data, because historic data is given to the machine, right? Now, learning from that, it predicts that that patient, that particular client or say person, yes, he may acquire diabetes because he's having some unhealthy habits, which are recorded in the form of parameter X1, X2, X3 and X4. Did you understand now?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Yes. What about others? At least 2-3 confirmations. Did you understand what is classification and what is regression?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Very good. And you know, understood what is an assumption?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Very good. So you're trying to assume, you're trying to think that a particular thought about the data is correct up to some extent, at least until you see the performance of the model. Now, if it is not satisfactory, you go back to refine your assumption. You go back to change your assumption. But if it is satisfactory, yes, your assumption might be correct. Okay. Now, the next point is data processing, data pre-processing. What is data pre-processing? You're trying to pre-process or clean your data. See, data taken from real-time scenario may not be clean. It may have duplicate values. It may have, say, null values, or it may have erroneous values, values which are recorded wrongly, or it may have outliers. So all these, this kind of, drawbacks in the data that is recorded will give you deviations in the results, that will deviate your results. Because there is an extreme outlier, your model may be giving bad performance. Why? Because it is not able to understand why there is an extreme behavior. See, in this diabetes patient prediction, if you have, he eats junk food, he has overweight, he drinks and he smokes, and he doesn't acquire diabetes. This is an outlier, right? He has all the bad habits possible in his life, but he is predicted to not acquire diabetes. That is an exceptional case. That is that can be treated as an outlier, correct? So that kind of outliers have to be removed. Otherwise, your machine will learn wrong things. Your machine will understand in a wrong way that all unhealthy habits are still healthy, because the patient doesn't acquire any disease, correct? So you should not provide the machine with wrong data. And I always talk about GIGO, that is garbage in, garbage out. If you feed garbage to the machine learning algorithm, garbage only will be sent out. You will be given wrong results, from which you do wrong interpretations, from which you derive wrong conclusions. That may not be useful in any way. It is better not to do any machine learning on that particular data. Okay, so you have to clean the data. You have to pre-process the data. And remember, 80% of the time in developing a machine learning application may be spent only in cleaning the data, right? This is the Parrot's principle. In economics, you come across this principle, right? This can be applied in various domains. And here, 80% of the time you're spending on data pre-processing, and only 20% of the time you're spending on fitting the machine learning algorithms to the data after cleaning. Okay, that is the importance of data pre-processing for any machine learning expert, for any data analyst, for any data scientist, right? Now, I frequently talk about features. What is a feature? What is feature of Shashank? What are the features that explain about Shashank?
Skinny,
okay.
Loose pant.
Okay. He wears pets, right?
Oh. Yes, ma'am. Which Shashank? Yeah.
No, Shashank. Okay, like that. Or by taking a person, he is a fair complexion, but nowadays that has to be avoided, right? Because of some, lot of issues has happened in US. And you take the features which better explain a person, means characteristics of that person. He'll be late to the class, he's little mischievous during the class, like that. That is how we learn about a student. So the features are parameters or characteristics which are attributes which explain a particular data point. Okay, now let me clear this screen. I'll start once. Yeah, you can see the blank screen, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I have some features like weight of a person, height of a person, his performance in sports, his performance in academics, sports performance, academic performance, like that. Okay, some characteristics about student 1, student 2, student 3, student 4. Right? Now these are called as my sample points, or I can call them as my data points. I can simply call them as rows in the data. Right? And what are these? These are called as attributes or features or properties or characteristics that explain each of the students S1, S2, S3 and S4. Right? So when I say features, you should understand it as attributes of that particular data point, sample, attributes of that particular sample. Right? That is what I mean by when I talk about features, that is what I mean. Okay. Now, what is function approximation? Now, there is a value y, which can be represented as a function of x. Okay? Now, if I say x square and I give x the values 1, 2, 3, 4, what would be the value of y? 1, 4, 9, 16. Correct? So what I'm trying to do here is, I'm trying to explain y as a function of x. This is called as function approximation. And in regression, we normally do this function approximation. Say, I'm trying to say that parameter x1 and 2 times parameter x2 and 5.6 times parameter x3 will help me to predict the price of a house. X1 may be the square feet occupied by that house, and X2 is the locality in which it is situated, and X3 may be the tax rate on that particular house, and all these will help me to predict the sale price of that house. And in that, tax rate will play an important role in predicting the sale price of that house, and the square feet it occupies will play a moderate role. And the locality it is situated in will play a very less role in predicting the sale price of that house, that is y. Now I'm trying to fit a linear equation for this particular problem, that is predicting the sale price of a house. This is called as function approximation. I'm trying to define a function. I'm trying to define a linear equation that will help me in predicting what would be the future data point. Now, future outcome of the data point. Now, you are given a new house's description. You are given in which locality it is situated, how much square feet it occupies, and what is the tax rate in that particular area. You have the quotients 2, 5.6 and 1. You have the quotients, right? Or you have the rate at which x1, x2, x3 will impact y, will influence y. Am I clear to you? These are called as quotients. This 2, this 5.6 and this 1, these are called as quotients. Means at what rate they influence the outcome variable y. Those are called as the quotients. Now, you are given the square feet of the house, the tax rate in that particular locality, and what is the other one I said? Property, in which locality it is situated. Correct? Now, when you are given these three parameters, you have the equation ready. Just substitute them in x1, x2, x3 and you can easily predict the sale price of that house. Means what I'm doing is fitting a function or a linear equation to explain my historic data so that the new parameters, if substituted in that particular function or in that linear equation, I should be able to predict the sale price of that house. This is called as function approximation. Any doubt in this?
No, ma'am.
Okay. If at all you have any doubt, just replay the video. Okay. I try to make it as clear as possible. So if you can just see the video once again, I think you will be able to understand if at all you're somewhere stuck. Right? This is called a function approximation problem. And now you know what is an assumption, what is data pre-processing, and what is its importance, and how features play an important role in predicting a particular data, a new data point, after learning from the old data points. Okay, all this. Now, what is an algorithm? What is a machine learning or just any algorithm? You know the basic definition of an algorithm, right? A step-by-step implementation of some task. Now, what are machine learning algorithms? I keep talking that you can select machine learning algorithms in order to fit this particular data, which better explains the behavior of the data. So what is this machine learning algorithm? What it does basically? Machine learning algorithms. Yeah, yes.
Ma'am, algorithm will predict data correctly.
Predict the data correctly. Yes. Predict the data correctly or regress the data correctly. Okay. I said it is two kinds of problems always. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Sadev, you are using a more generalized term. That is good. Predicting something. Predicting whether it belongs to a particular class or not, or predicting a sale price, or predicting a stock price, or predicting the rainfall in a particular area. Yes. That it is trying to predict something by a step-by-step approach. Say you have lots of algorithms like k-nearest neighbor algorithm and k-means algorithm. You might have heard about all these, right? Linear regression, multilinear regression, logistic regression. What are all these? These are algorithms which have some underlying implementation which suits a particular type of data. Remember, all one algorithm doesn't suit all the context, all the situations, all the data. In the same way, one data set can't be answered by all the algorithms. Okay, you should see the best match. It is something like a matrimonial website where you find the best match based on the performance of that algorithm with that particular data, right? So if you have COVID patients data set and you have to classify them according to the age, in that case it is a classification problem. But if you want to find out the recovery rate, it is a regression problem. And if you want to cluster the zones, because there are more patients, according to the density of population in that particular area, that should be a containment zone. It should be the red zone. Now, there are same number of cases in a different area and the density is too high, then it should be an orange zone, or based on that some ratio. Okay, the algorithm should be able to cluster it into red zone, green zone, and orange zone. What it is doing here? Clustering. It is trying to group the areas. This is called as clustering problem. Okay. So based on the data given, based on the outcome you are expecting that particular machine to perform, you are trying to find the best matching algorithm. Right? That is why Again, you're making assumptions here that this algorithm would match this data set or this particular task. It may match, may not match. You can test your assumption only by the performance it gives or with what accuracy it does that particular task of classifying or predicting or clustering, with what accuracy it does that. With that, you should be able to check your assumptions whether that algorithm is a suitable match or not. Did you understand now? What is a machine learning algorithm?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, good. So sometimes I call as best fit, right? What is a best fit? Now, I have two types of whenever you are given a data set, you should divide that data set into training set and test set. These also will be using frequently. What is a training set and a test set? Normally, this division will be in the ratio of 80-20 or 70-30. Means 70% of the data is taken as training data from which the machine will learn, and 30% of the data will be test or validation data. From the name itself, you should be able to understand. Test or validation data means after the machine learns from the training set, this test set will be given with the parameters, but not the labels, but not the outcome variables. Means X1, X2, X3, X4 will be given to the machine, but Y is not given to the machine. Y is kept hidden. Now, you will ask the machine, based on your training you obtained from this 70% of the data, you try to predict the class by using this test set's parameters, X1, X2, X3, and X4. Right. It predicted. It predicted Y1, Y2, Y3, Y4 for four different data points. Now, you already hid some data, right? You already kept some data in secrecy. Now, compare these predictions with the original labels or with the original classes. This is same, yes. Same, 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 yes. All the predictions are correct. Means your model is performing with 100% accuracy. So this is called as best fit model. Now, this is a wrong prediction. Original predictions are these. These are the predictions made by your machine. Now, there is one wrong prediction, but three correct predictions. So what is the accuracy in this case? Student? 75%.
75%, ma'am.
Very good. 75%. So when what is the accuracy here? 75% accuracy means 75% performance it is showing. What did you understand from this? I'm just giving you example of four data points, but in real time you try to do it with thousands of data points. In that case, 95% accuracy is a good accuracy. 90% accuracy is a good accuracy. But if it starts going below 80 or below 70, then you say that its accuracy is falling down. Means its performance is going down. That indicates this may not be a best fit. Because when a new data point is given, it is not being able to generalize properly. It is not being able to predict with good accuracy. That is why it may not be a best fit. Means your selection of a particular algorithm might be wrong. You might try with a different algorithm to get the best performance. Got it? What is best fit now? Okay. Now, I would like to come back to our basic definition of machine learning in module 1, what I have given. Can anybody repeat that definition? Students? Can anybody repeat the definition of machine learning? I think now when I explain that, it will be more clear to you. I'll just open it for you. What are the three important terms in the definition? Do you remember?
E, P, and T, ma'am.
T, E, and P, exactly. So what is that T, E, and P? Can you elaborate on that?
Experience, task, and performance.
Experience, task, and performance. Now, see the definition clearly. Now you will be able to understand. A computer program is set to learn from experience E. What is the experience E? In a classification task, say the task is to detect whether a transaction is fraudulent or not. What is the experience? How can a machine learn?
Like it will detect whether it is right or wrong.
Old data, historic data. It might have the banks or any financial institutions, they might have recorded the previous transaction data, right?
Yes, ma'am.
From that, it might have noted down, it might have learned whether a transaction is fraudulent or not. That is the experience you provide to the machine. The historic data of lots of transactions, hundreds of transactions in the previous days, that will be given as data from which experience can be obtained by a computer program or by a machine. Okay, so it has come across so many parameters. Okay, at this geographic location, if this amount of money is used and with this much frequency, at this much intervals of time, say they have used the debit card now, then after 10 minutes, then after 15 minutes, then 20 minutes, frequent transactions are being done at a completely different geographic location than the customer's geographic location. Then the machine may sense some mischief in that. It may be a fraudulent transaction. Immediately, it will sense that, send an alert message to the customer through the bank saying that, is this you who is performing the transaction at this geographic location? If you say yes, only then the transaction will be processed. If not, then your card will be blocked. Is this done in 1 day duration or 1 hour duration? It is done in fractions of seconds. Means the machine has learned that this kind of parameter combination is a suspicious combination, or this kind of parameter combination is a genuine combination. It has learned that from previous thousands of transactions. That is called as experience. Understood, student? Now, what is the task it is trying to perform? What is T here? It is trying to predict whether a transaction is fraudulent or not. It is trying to classify whether a transaction is fraudulent or not. That is T. Then what is P? It is a fraudulent transaction, but it failed to detect that fraudulent transaction. Then it is called as, then if we say that the performance is not up to the mark, it is not able to detect the fraudulent transaction, right? So we say that performance is bad. But if it is a fraudulent transaction and it also detected to be a fraudulent transaction, then the performance is better at that particular task. Means a machine is performing with good accuracy to perform the task of predicting whether a transaction is fraudulent or not by learning from the experience of historic data. Now you understood the definition clearly?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, so we'll again repeat what concepts have been covered in first chapter so far from the Monday's class, and I think from there we can smoothly go on because you understood the very basic terminology that we use in machine learning. Okay, meet you in the next class. Thank you.